All right, so I suppose we have until 3 o'clock, right? We have a class at 3?
No, sir.
Well, actually, no, I have a meeting at 3. So it has to be till 3 only. Okay, so in the previous lecture, I had talked about the momentum operator. So we were talking about what the Schrodinger equation is, what the structure of the Schrodinger equation is, and so what I had explained to you is that we start in classical mechanics. There are two different descriptions of classical systems. Those two descriptions are equivalent. They give you the same answers for all systems, but there is a difference when it comes to talking about the quantum theory. So there is one description is called the Lagrangian description, where the variables of which parameterize your system are given by the positions and velocity. And the other is the Hamiltonian description, where the variables are positions and momenta. And as I said, that even though this might seem like just a very superficial distinction, there are many cases in which the velocity and the momentum are not simply related by something like P is equal to mv. So this distinction really does make a difference. And then I talked about how many degrees of freedom there are in a given system. So, and what is a point in phase space? So a phase space is basically the space of all your these variables, these positions and momenta, right? So for if you have a particle moving on a plane or on a straight line, if you have a particle moving on a line, then for instance, your configuration variable x can be any point on the real line, and your momenta can be any point also again on the real line. But this does not always have to be the case. For instance, you can have a particle which is moving on a circle. So if you have a particle moving on a circle, what will be your configuration, your position variable? Will it be the real line? Anybody? For a particle moving on a circle, what will be your position variable? Will it take values in the real line from minus infinity to plus infinity? Rishika? Kusum, anybody wants to make a guess? Sorry, Aditya?
Sir, we need x and y coordinates.
Well, no, I said it's moving on a circle, right? Okay, so let's say
we can parameterize.
You can parameterize it in terms of x and y, but if I just say the position along the circle, that's your x.
We need something like theta.
Let's say you're right, your position is theta. Then what is the range of theta?
0 to 2 pi,
right?
Yeah.
So the point is that this configuration space is not necessarily just the real line or the real plane. Okay, it depends on the system in question. Similarly, the momentum need not be just the infinite moment, the real line, because in many cases you can have momenta. You can have systems where the momentum, for instance, can take discrete values, or it has some upper bound, or in some cases it can even have a minimum lower bound. Okay. So a point in phase space gives you the description of the entire system, right? It tells you the positions of all the particles and the momenta of all the particles, right? So this is a very simple system. This is the simplest possible system. The moment you start talking about more complicated systems, your phase space becomes larger and larger. And So a trajectory in phase space, right? Any trajectory connecting one point to another point to another point tells you that the system is changing, right? And as it changes, the state of the system is changing, and the trajectory gives you the evolution of that state, right? So a point in phase space corresponds to a state of the system. This is the classical state, okay? Hamiltonian is given by, typically in most cases, the sum of the kinetic plus the potential energy. As an example, I gave you the harmonic oscillator. And then I told you that there are these Hamilton's equations of motions, which again, if you are not familiar with, you will definitely encounter in classical mechanics. And we worked it out, and we see that, well, we get the usual harmonic oscillator solution, right? Now, we want to talk about quantum mechanics, right? So we want to go from the classical Hamiltonian to the quantum Hamiltonian. And when we do that, our system will be described by the Schrodinger equation, which is given by this expression, where H is the Hamiltonian operator. And this is the operator for the total energy of the system. And so this makes sense, because this expression is saying that what is the energy of the system, and this is also the same thing, right? So it's like left hand side is equal to right hand side, right? So then I talked about how to write down the Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian for a part, anything, well, it's kinetic energy plus potential energy. And what is kinetic energy? P square by 2m, right? And remember, since we are working with Hamiltonian, we have to talk in terms of momenta, not in terms of velocities. So, but now P is an operator, right? It is not a number, right? And what is this operator? This operator is a derivation with respect to the x coordinate. Now, I was giving you some motivation. I had started talking about, first I explained how to take the square of such an operator. If you do that, you can see that this is what your Hamiltonian operator becomes. And your Hamiltonian operator acting on some function is equal to this part. This is the left-hand side of the Schrodinger equation. So your Schrodinger equation is a differential equation, right? Of course, even in classical mechanics, your Hamilton's equations of motion are also differential equations. So as a motivation for why the momentum operator should have this form, I talked about de Broglie's hypothesis. Then I introduced this expression, which is a wave. This is the equation for a wave, which is moving with some velocity, v is equal to omega by k. Right? Because it's a function both of x and t. So if you make a plot of this, the plot doesn't just look like a wave, because as time moves forward, the wave also keeps moving forward, right? So it's a moving wave, which a velocity is given by omega by k. Omega is equal to the angular frequency, right? So angular frequency has units of radians per second. And f is the frequency, that is in units of per second. K is called the wave vector, and it has a value 2 pi divided by the wavelength. If you don't know these facts, please go to Wikipedia or some other source, read up on the equation of a traveling wave, a plane wave. Okay, these are all very, very simple and basic facts. So I don't want to spend half an hour on these. So now if we ask, according to de Broglie, what is the momentum of this wave? The momentum is given by 2 pi by k, right? And what is p? Sorry, the wavelength is 2 pi by k. What is p? P is equal to h by lambda, which is h bar k. And how can I get this k out of this wave or wave function? How can I do that? Well, one way to get it out of it is by taking a derivation with respect to, When I do that, however, my function changes. It's no longer cosine, it becomes sine. If I take another derivation, I get cosine again, right? And so what is the if I say that this is my operator d by dx squared, the eigenvalue of this operator is minus p squared by x squared, right? And so if I compare the left and right hand side, right, I can associate with this operator minus I h bar d by dx, I can associate an operator p, okay? And then I gave you an example of a superposition, right? So you can have a function which is a superposition of many different plane waves. So in this case, each wave has a different momentum, right? Because it depends on the value of k. And then I talked about what happens if you measure this wave, what is the momentum that you're going to measure, right? And so this is important because this wave function doesn't correspond to a single momentum. It corresponds to a linear superposition of two plane waves with different momenta. When you perform a measurement, what happens is that the system collapses into one state or the other state. And so we'll talk in a little bit more detail about this collapse process a little bit later. Now, I had asked you to find the eigenstates of this, right? So the eigenstates of this operator, they're very straightforward. This is minus I h bar d by dx. So what is the eigenstate? The eigenstate satisfies this equation, right? This is the eigenvalue equation. I hope that everybody understands such equations. If you have any difficulty understanding any of the notation, you can please stop and ask, okay? Right, so this is my differential equation, and this is very easily solved, right? Why? Because I can take f over here and I can write this as I lambda by h bar, right? And then I integrate both sides, so I get that f, sorry?
Turn into dx.
Say that clear. I
didn't. So right hand side, there's a term, not dx.
Dx, yes, thank you. So f of x is going to be some constant exponent I lambda x by, right? And if I take the derivative of this with respect to x, I will just get I lambda by h bar outside. And that's what I, so this is my eigenstate of momentum, right? And notice that this eigenstate can be written as a sum of a cosine so what is this lambda by h bar, by the way? Lambda is equal to h by p, and so lambda by h bar is equal to just want to make sure that I'm getting my dimensions right. H by p, one second.
Ix by p.
Ix by p. Okay, thank you.
2 pi also.
Where? 2 pi? 2 pi is where? On the top right.
X into 2 pi. Yeah. Okay,
2 pi Ix. 2 pi Ix by p. No, p should be in the... Sorry. This is... right, so this lambda is not the wavelength. My bad. This is not the wavelength, right? This is the eigenvalue of this operator. So actually, instead of using lambda, which is a very bad notation, I should just use the number p. Okay, I'll just use the number p because that's the eigenvalue of the momentum. So I get exponent 2 pi I p. And this depends on the parameter p. So we'll put a p over here, a label p, to indicate that this depends on p. And this is a sum of a cosine and a sine using Euler's formula, right? Similarly, what will be the eigen state with momentum minus p? It will just be f of minus p, right? It will be a exponent minus 2 pi I p. And this is in one dimension, remember. All of this is in one dimension. Okay. Now, so let's
In that, you change the lambda to p, right? In the notation.
Yeah, lambda is not the wavelength, lambda is the eigenvalue. Yeah.
So where is the h, like?
H cross is missing.
H bar is missing, right? So I'll put an h bar here.
H, right?
So if you divide p by h bar, then you will get k. Right? P is equal to h bar k. So when you take this h bar, put it in the denominator, divide p by h bar, you will get kx. So,
but then there won't be 2 pi in the numerator, right?
No, there won't be 2 pi in the numerator. Fine. There won't be 2 pi in the numerator. Thank you. Yeah, okay. All right. Okay. So f of p is equal to a exponent ikx. Now, so let's look at our Hamiltonian again. Our Hamiltonian is p square by 2m, right? So these solutions, they are eigenstates of this Hamiltonian. We can see that. Why? Because this is an eigenstate of the momentum operator p. So it will also be an eigenstate of the moment of the square of the momentum operator, right? And if you just take h and act on f, what you will get is, you will get p square by 2m by f. Where what is p? P will turn out to be just h bar k. Right. Now this is a time independent object. You can see that because it doesn't have any dependence on the time, right? There's no t parameters, none there. So then you might ask, well, what happens to the right hand side of the Schrodinger equation? Right. So the right hand side of the Schrodinger equation, as I told you, is I h bar d by dt, right? Of psi xt. So where did the time dependence go? So the thing is that the time dependence is there. We just haven't included it. If I include the time dependence, my function will become a exponent I kx minus omega t. And now you can see that this is of the same form, right, that I got over here. Only difference is that it's an exponential instead of a sine or a cosine. But the argument is the same, it's x minus omega t. Right? So now let's ask what is this? So if we have a Hamiltonian, we can ask what are the allowed energy values? Right? So this is an eigenvalue problem. And okay, and so what happens to the left-hand side when I take this derivation with respect? So let me be a little bit more. What's the word? Let me go a little bit step by step. So this is my full time dependent wave function. Okay. Now if I act on this with the Hamiltonian, okay, on the left hand side, so p square by 2m f, and there is no potential, okay, so I'm not putting that in, this equal to minus I h bar d by dt of f. And what is this going to be? If I take d by dt, I will get minus I omega minus minus. So I guess maybe this should be a plus. I get confused about this. Please read your textbook also so that you can
sir, get the right. Sir, I have a doubt. Yeah, sir, I have a question, sir. In a free particle case, the momentum, the function of momentum will be a to the power, what you have written, exponential iota k minus omega t. But in a 1D box, how we will get the expression?
Beta, I'm not at 1D box yet. Na?
Okay, okay, sir. Okay, sorry, sir.
I'll come to that. Na?
Okay, sir.
Okay. So this is I h bar, and when you take the derivative, you will get minus I omega minus minus. So you will get h bar omega, and then you will get f. So this will be our eigenvalue equation. I can just write this as E times F. Now, if you look at this equation for F, F can be written as F of XT. It can be written as a function of X multiplied by this phase factor, which depends on time, right? So when you act on this with this p square by 2m, what will you get? You'll just get e to the minus I omega t, because that is not going to be affected by p square, right? P is a derivation with respect to x. It will not act on the part which depends on t. You'll get this. And on the right side, what do you get? You get this e, energy, times e to the minus I omega t fpx. So now we can see that this phase factor just cancels out. And after removing this phase factor, what are we left with? We are left with a equation which does not contain time. Right, so there is no dependence on time in this. So this is called the time independent Schrodinger equation. Okay, also often abbreviated as TISE. Right, so there is no time either on the left or the right side, right? And now I can ask, so I have this, in this expression, I have this E, the energy. I can ask, what are the allowed energy values? So if I'm on the real line, right? If I am in a one dimensional, if I have a particle moving in one dimension, then what are my allowed values of momenta? My momenta can be anything from zero to infinity, right? So my energy is going to be any real number, right? It's going to be equal to h bar square k square by 2m, where k belongs to r. K is just any real number. So this is for a free particle in one dimension, right? There is no potential, nothing. So now, if you are in a laboratory setting, typically you don't have free objects, right? For instance, if you have an object, you would like it to stay within the walls of your laboratory. Let's say these are the walls of my laboratory. This is the object, right? And it's free to move about anywhere here, but it can't go outside the lab, right? So here it's free, but here there is a potential barrier which keeps the object inside the lab. And how can I represent this? Why do I call it a potential barrier? Because let's say that you have some particle and you want to keep it to the left of this region, right? You want to keep it to the left of this region. You want to make this region on the right forbidden. So how do you do that? Well, one way to do that is to put a potential U of X, right? Which has this form, which looks like this. Okay. So here, for instance, in this region, we can say U of X is zero. And in this region, we can say U of X is equal to something plus U naught. Okay. Now you remember that when a particle is in a certain potential, it feels a force which is given by negative of the derivative of the potential, right? Negative of the gradient, right? So when you look at this expression here, what is the force? It is zero because the potential is not changing. Here the force is zero, the potential is not changing. But what happens here? Here, du by dx, right, becomes large and positive. So what happens? The particle feels a force in the negative x direction. You understand? Is this clear or not? What is going on in this picture? If it's not clear, please ask. I will explain. And please remember, the particle is moving along a line. It is not going up and down. So this axis, the vertical axis, is not position. The vertical axis is energy, potential energy. The horizontal axis is the position. Okay. Similarly, if I want the same thing to happen on the left hand side, what do I do? Well, I make my potential here also have this shape. Once again, what is happening here? My potential is decreasing very rapidly. No? When I go from here to here, my potential decreases. So du by dx is large and negative. And so that means at this point, the particle will feel a force which is large and positive. So whenever the particle tries to go to the left, it feels a force that pushes it back to the right. Whenever it tries to go to the right, it gets pushed back to the left. Whenever it tries to go to the left, it gets pushed back here. Right? This is what is called a potential trap, right? The particle is trapped inside this potential. Now, can the particle escape this potential? Is there any scope for escaping?
Sir, for classical particle, it's not possible.
For classical particle, it's not possible.
But if its energy is greater than potential,
is greater than what?
U naught.
U naught, right. So if the particle's energy is greater than U naught, it can climb up the potential and leave, no?
Yes, sir.
Right? So if the particle's energy is greater than U naught, it can go from region, so I'll give this name region 1, I'll call this region 3 and region 2. If the particle's energy is greater than U naught, when it is in region 2, then it can go to either region 1 or region 3. And when it goes to either one of these regions, its energy will end up, it will end, still end up with a positive energy with the U not taken out of it, right? That is the amount of work that it needs to do to go to that region. Okay. So how can you keep the particle, how can you make sure that the particle never goes out of this box? Right? How can we make the walls impenetrable? Right? Which means we don't want the particle to ever escape the box. What should we do?
Making potential infinite.
We just take the U to infinite. Okay. So this becomes a, this is called an infinite potential. The correct, you can call it a trap also. It's called a well. So this is a finite potential well. And when you send the potential to infinity, you get an infinite potential. We have region 1, region 2, region 3. Here we say U is infinite, U is infinite, U is equal to 0. Okay? Any questions? Okay, so now when we talked about a completely free particle, we saw that the energy can take any real value. Well, energy is always positive, so energy is always within R plus, but momentum can take any real value, right? What happens when we put a particle inside a potential well? Right, so now what we have to do is, How do we solve, what do we do? We have to solve Schrodinger's equation. And we'll solve the time independent Schrodinger equation. And what is the time independent Schrodinger equation? H, what is the Hamiltonian? It's P square by 2m. But now remember, there is a potential, U of x, right? This U of x, this is a discontinuous potential, right? So we have to specify it piece by piece. We'll call this x is equal to 0, x is equal to L. So we have that it's equal to 0 when x is between 0 and L, and it's equal to infinity if x is greater than L or if x is less than 0. This is our potential, right? So when we solve this equation, this eigenvalue equation, we have two regions. We have region 1 and region 3. Both of them are the same because the potential is infinite. And we have region 2 where the potential is 0. Now for solving this, what we will do is we will take U to be something not infinite, okay? We'll take it to be U naught. We'll take U naught to go to infinity once we have the solution. So we want to solve, let's say, for, if you want to solve for region 2. For region 2, U of x is just 0. Region 2 is the central part, remember. So what is the solution of this equation? The solution of this equation, this is an eigenvalue equation, right? It's just f of x is equal to a times e to the kx plus b times e to the minus kx. There will be two linearly independent solutions. You have to take both of them. Okay. But now we have not, you will see that there is a restriction on the allowed values of k. K cannot be any real number, right? There is a reason for that. The reason is that when you look at regions 1 and 3, what is the solution? Well, here u of x is equal to u naught. Right. So now my Schrodinger equation, I get a constant u naught term here. E of f, right? Now I can rewrite this as E minus u naught times f, right? I can always take this expression. Whether it's a constant or not, doesn't matter. I can always take it to the right hand. In this case, it's a constant, right? Because u naught is a constant. Now, what is the solution of this equation? The solution of this equation will be exactly the same as the solution of this equation. No? They're both identical. The only difference is here that you have E minus U naught. So here, what is the relationship between K and E? It will be E is equal to H bar square K square by 2M. Here, what you will get is F of X is equal to C times e to the I k prime x and minus I k prime. What is k prime? K prime is equal to, k prime is related to the energy. Now what is the energy? E minus u naught. This has to be equal to h bar square k prime squared by 2. Right? So you see that here, in this case, your momentum is given by root 2 me by h bar. And here, your momentum is given by root 2 m e minus u naught by h bar. Okay. Now I'll stop here because, as I said, I have another meeting. We will continue in our next class, which will be on Monday. Okay. In the meantime, those of you who are interested, you can go ahead and solve this problem. please ask me any questions. I might want to take a class on Saturday if that's not a problem with you all. Would that be okay? Please let me know if that would be okay or not. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Mm. Okay. Are there any questions?
Sir, when we write a equation for a free particle, there term k minus omega t. Sir, this k represents a single wave lambda or superposition of lambda.
Which one are you talking about? This one?
Sir, let's suppose there is a particle which is moving in a free space without any potential. So, sir, there will be equations for the psi equal to something a into the power kx minus omega t. So, sir, there will be a k. So, corresponding to that k, will there be a single lambda or multiple lambda? Because when we come to the wave packet, there are a superposition of many lambdas.
So, I've told you that what does the lambda depend on? How is lambda related to k?
Yes, sir.
How is lambda related to k? What is the relation between k and lambda?
sir, k equal 2 pi by lambda.
2 pi by lambda, no? So if I write something like this, if I write something like okay, where you have k1 and k2.
Okay, sir.
Does this have a single wavelength?
No, sir.
Hmm?
No, sir.
No. Does this have a single wavelength?
Yes, sir.
Right. Why? Because this is a single eigenstate. And this is a superposition of eigenstates. Eigenstates of momentum.
Yes, sir.
Does this answer your question?
No, sir. My question was regarding when we talk about the wave packet, there
is a wave packet. Listen, no? This is a wave packet only. No? What is this? This is not a wave packet. Is this a wave packet or not?
Yes, sir.
Then it's a wave packet with only two wavelengths, but it's still a more complicated wave packet can have n number of wavelengths. Okay. Go and read your textbook also a little bit. Okay. I think that will also clarify many things. All right. I'm going to end the recording here.